our panel. I want to bring up Bobby Majumdar. he is a member of TiEDallas and managing partner law at Perkins Coie. So, Bobby.
This is like speaking right before cocktail hour. Nobody wants to be here. But appreciate y'all coming out. It's a great opportunity to see all the people that are interested in blockchain technology. We have a great panel this morning. I saw Adam just sneak out, but Adam's supposed to be up here. We also have Meltem, Demirors from Digital Currency Group, and my partner Lowell Ness, who is the managing partner of Perkins Coie's Palo Alto office, and also the guy that did Overstock IPO using blockchain technology. So I'd ask them to come up. No, I think Adam may have went for a bio break. I'm not sure, but y'all come on up. And in the interest of time, we'll start, and then Adam can join in. I guess the first question I'd have for y'all is, where do you? Oh, there he goes. All right. So as investors, where do y'all see the trend in terms of the business model for blockchain business? Is it software as a service, where blockchain companies are actually providing their technology as a product, or is it more consulting, working with other companies that are embedding blockchain in their business models?
Blockchain, helping them implement it, deploy it, is doing POCs. Those are one-time revenue hits. That's a very challenging way to build a business. Mm-hmm. And so the challenge we see right now is there's a lot of interest in blockchain technology. There's a lot of interest from corporates, governments, institutions. Just this morning, the government of Ukraine announced they're going to be deploying blockchain mm-hmm. in their national systems. So there's a lot of interest from a lot of different parties. And the challenge is our 100 startups, most of them have come via Adam or others, he's kind of our early pipeline. But a lot of them are at this stage where maybe they have 10 employees, maybe they have 12, and there's this massive funnel of inbound interest in blockchain. And there's so much education that needs to happen, and startups can't do it alone, which is why I think it's so important that WorldLink is organizing events like these, why firms like Perkins and others can sort of help in that process. But I think everyone's still challenged by this question of, are we selling products? Mm-hmm. Are we selling integration services? Are we selling advisory work? Is it SaaS? Is it something different altogether? And I think it's going to take some time for that blockchain sort of enterprise technology stack to mature before people will really identify in what part of the stack they're playing and what the business model should be.
Yeah, I think that's completely correct. It's sort of the fundamental startup question. It's not like blockchain only or Bitcoin. It's like, where's the money?
Right.
It's like a fundamental question of where are we going to find the money to be able to sustain ourselves? But I will say, just on a like crypto or digital token basis, like the common like way to make money has evolved. Like when it was Bitcoin, it was very transactional. When it was blockchain, it's become very POC, work for a big company oriented. That like there are these evolutions in the business happening. Like a lot of people think speculation on the digital assets is becoming another way to make money. So that's what I would say. Like business model, it's no different than a business. So you need to figure out where the money is, where the opportunity is.
So Lowell, in the companies that you're acting for and you see in out in the valley, do you see trends one way or the other? Do you see industry sectors in which the blockchain technology is more aptly being used, as opposed to, you know, I mean, to Adam's statement earlier about sprinkling fairy dust on everything. It was like, you know, 15 years ago when we had the dot-com bubble, everybody just put a dot-com at the end of their name, and boom, they got a 15% rise in enterprise value. But, you know.
Yeah, you know, I think, to me, the best possible use case is this identity thing. It's also the scariest. But when you start to layer on attributes, it sort of becomes harder and harder to lie to each other, and harder to break the law. We probably all broke the law getting here by exceeding the speed limit. But once you start adding not only our credit history to our identity that's immutable, but it's sort of the killer app for Big Brother when you actually stop and thinking about it. But in the meantime, it's actually a really helpful, useful tool that I want, right? Because I use LastPass, and it's a pain in the ass to put in my identity every time. But I love identity. That's my favorite one. I think it's got the most legs to kind of be just amazingly ubiquitous. But it's also the scariest. There's scary stuff that we're talking about here. You know, these distributed autonomous organizations is another one we didn't talk about today. Another kind of scary thing that you start to have these organizations, these open source communities kind of collaborating with each other, using digital currency to incentivize, you know, people to do things. And then you start writing, you know, smart contracts, and you start to have all the building blocks for Skynet, you know, right there. Yeah, and so really interesting, fun, far-fetched stuff that we're all kind of at the very beginning of exploring. But I think in terms of the really sort of simple, easy to understand, easy to get sort of use cases, Factum's a really good example of one where, you know, you're just doing exactly what's needed right now for a business that is you can sell tomorrow, and they are.
Actually, all of these companies that just presented were really good range, you know, supply chain management data. It's really interesting to, this was a good selection, I would say. This was really fun for me, anyway. I finally know what everyone does.
You know, so for someone like me who's a little bit more novice about this, is it a reasonable statement to say that Bitcoin is in fact an application of blockchain technology? The product of blockchain technology? They're not synonymous terms, correct?
I can jump in here. So the way I conceptualize the difference between Bitcoin and blockchain and this technology trend overall is I would view this as just another disruptive technology innovation like IoT, like AR and VR, like AI and machine learning. Blockchain and Bitcoin are one category of technologies focused on distributed protocols. Just this distributed ledger term is one that's used often. Bitcoin is one specific type of distributed ledger. It has very specific rules that govern the core protocol, and those rules happen to pertain to the creation of money, the management of the fiscal system associated with that money supply. And there are other protocols like Ethereum. There are now protocols like Zcash and Monero and Dash that have different features like financial privacy embedded in them. Ripple is another one that some people may be familiar with that has yet another set of rules that sort of govern the protocol, how tokens are created, managed, who has the rights to change things, how transactions work. But really all these things are is they're protocols. They are computer systems that have rules about what you can and can't do and who can and can't do it. And so when you look at the wide range of protocols out there, there are those that have tokens. Bitcoin is one example. The Bitcoin blockchain has a financial incentive attached to it. But there are other blockchains being developed or distributed ledgers being developed by R3. They have their own sort of distributed ledger-like technology that don't have that financial incentive. And I think the great trend has been, for a long time, cryptography was not cool. I studied applied math, and like cryptography was this weird niche thing that no one really did. Most people associated it with the Enigma machine from World War II. But now it's starting to bring the dialogue around applied cryptography into the enterprise. And so I think the question is now becoming, well, do I need a distributed ledger? Do I want just applied cryptography, which has become kind of an offshoot of blockchain? Or do I want distributed computing for which I could use a blockchain, I could use cryptography, but it's a different thing altogether. So I think it's just a broad idea. Blockchain, unfortunately, is the word that we have all chosen. I think it's here to stay, right? Do you think so? We're stuck with it.
I don't know. It's the word changes. You know, like we evolved from altcoin to Bitcoin to then we passed it to blockchain. I was upset when that happened. I thought we were just sticking with Bitcoin all the way. And then
did you get your Bitcoin tattoo already? Is that
No. No, I have that classic clean cut look that never goes out of style. I think that we say Bitcoin and blockchain analogously just because it was the first mass market blockchain. It was the first that people really, it inspired everyone to build and change and things. And so that's the reason that they're like really referenced together. And like I actually sometimes say Bitcoin when I mean blockchain or blockchain when I mean Bitcoin. And it's just because sometimes I hate seeing Bitcoin and blockchain, and that's just sometimes how you have to do it. They're not the same thing, and I because Bitcoin has a blockchain, but there are other blockchains, and that's basically how I would phrase it.
So you made mention earlier this morning about ICO's initial coin offerings, which I will admit this was the first I've heard of that, and I've been doing securities law for a long time, and token sales. So what
role... We're keeping it from you, Bobby.
Yeah, exactly. I know. Y'all keep a lot of things from me. I understand that. I'm better off that way, probably. So what roles do ICOs or sales of tokens play in kind of bringing new protocols to market? And, you know, how are investors looking at these?
So I will say in the ICO market, there's sort of a problem right now that everyone's smart and has made tons of money in it. Like if you invested in Ethereum, like you're way up. If you invested in Bitcoin, like you're up at any point, as long as you held. if you didn't, I'm sorry. And so now all these people who made money or value, I would almost say, because it's crypto. They want to diversify. And so like there are these ICOs that happen all over the place. And so there is a risk, like there's a big risk that like the protocols that end up raising, there isn't any value actually there. So like you definitely want to do a lot of research. You want to understand who's there, what's there, all those things. But on the other side of it, I'm really excited about it because it is changing our industry. It's changing the way that people picture a corporation. It's changing the way that I picture a corporation. My dream long term, like my entire family has been in venture capital, and like I can't get away from it. But the my dream is to make venture capital accessible to the normal human being, like the average person. And that's such a odd thing to really desire. But I hate that the only people who have access to private equity are like foundations, endowments, like all these. It's a part of like their balanced portfolio, but the average person doesn't get that balanced portfolio, and that's such an odd thing for me. So like I think that the ICO is leading towards my end vision for how venture capital works.
I'm gonna disagree with you there. I don't think
perfect.
Let's create some drama here. I think there's a reason that venture capital and other really high risk asset classes aren't available to regular consumers, and it's because venture capital, maybe you disagree, is a skill set, right? Developing the aptitude to pick out early stage companies and invest in them and manage that life cycle is a skill set, right? That's why people pay you and me money. But I think the challenge with ICO.
Protecting your job, well done. I'm not too worried.
I'm not too worried about that. But I think the broader theme around ICOs is there's a paradigm shift from things being built on proprietary closed systems to things shifting towards open source. And a lot of people don't know this, but a lot of banks leverage open source technology. I think JP Morgan's tech stack is 60% open source. Right? So as this evolution's happening where things are evolving from closed systems to open
systems where power and control is distributed to the edges and to the individuals and institutions, it's introducing a fundamental paradigm shift in how these things get funded. And it goes back to the business model question. If I'm investing in open source technology as a venture investor, how do I make money? People build consulting firms on top of open source, like Red Hat is the example everyone cites that built a multi-billion dollar business on top of the Linux open source community. But not every business is going to have that capability. But how do these developers get paid? And I think this idea of tokens and incentivizing people to invest in the development of protocols where there are tokens that have real functional utility is an interesting theme. The challenge is there are a lot of people replicating that model and creating tokens that have zero functional utility, where the token is just like randomly thrown in. And that's where I worry. There's this irrational exuberance now. Their Bitcoin ecosystem, the crypto ecosystem, is worth close to $30 billion right now. Last year, it was closer to $7 billion, right? So that's a massive increase. And a lot of it is playing the lottery. You go on Poloniex, which is one of these sites where you can trade cryptocurrencies. It's literally like playing the lottery, where you go in, you bet on one cryptocurrency, it goes up. You're like, great, I'm going to find more that are going to double in value. And you start throwing your money around. It's literally like playing the lottery. So I think it's going to take time for there to be a little bit more discipline in what gets funded. But also, there's going to be a lot of really painful failures that unfortunately for our ecosystem will bring on a lot of damaging taint.
Yeah, well, it'll bring on regulation, like that retroactive thing that we were talking about before, where the regulations come but after something bad happens. Something bad is going to happen, definitely, in the ICO market. On the Red Hat thing, I always love when I'm talking to people about open source, and like they're always like, they're like, yeah, there's a business model. Red Hat did it.
It's like, every day
for open source. Red Hat did it. It's Red Hat and MongoDB did it, and then but those are like two of like many open source projects. And on the venture capital thing, yeah, us venture capitalists would love to pretend that it's like a skill set that everyone has. I don't think I'm necessarily, the reason I'm arguing against myself is that I don't think I'm necessarily better at selecting than like anyone. Like, I don't see how my judgment should be better than anyone else's. What defines my judgment away from everyone else's is my network, which I agree, like I have a competitive advantage there. But my judgment, I don't think I have a competitive advantage on. So I actually think the opposite, which is that venture capital should be accessible by everyone. So.
All right, but it's not, and there are securities laws.
Yes.
So,
for a reason, might I add,
here's the deal.
Well, it's protecting the endowments and foundations from the public being able to take control of their own money. I believe that.
I'm not here to say it's right or wrong.
And the only issue is that there's a 100 shareholder limit on venture capital funds. There's a limit of 35 unaccredited investors on any seed fund, which is weird because like, what if I had a family that was more than 35 people? Like, yeah. There are securities laws, but I actually believe that they are wrong, and they will be changed. I think that they're going to be changed over the next 5 to 10 years. You heard it here.
Should we put some Bitcoin on this?
I will literally.
I'm ready to gamble.
I will bet everyone here that in 10 years you will be able to go onto your wallet that you will have on your phone, and it won't be a phone. It'll be like your glasses. And you will be able to buy, you'll be listening to me and you'll be like, oh, how's BoostVC's like venture fund doing? Well, I might buy a little of that right now. And it's going to be awesome. So, you know, get ready for that future.
Yes, but, okay, here's the lawyer's
perspective. I'm the T1000.
Here's the lawyer's perspective. So in the early days of Bitcoin and these token sales, you know, it was scary stuff, and it was very obvious securities law violations. In fact, I think we disengaged from one of the early ones because we just got so scared about it. And we're now in kind of round two, and there's a bunch of token sales happening now, but a lot of these guys made enough money to do it right the second time, and there's enough money in the ecosystem that you can actually raise a lot of money on a token sale, but you have to be really careful about not violating securities laws, getting the money transmission stuff right.
Or you just do it in Switzerland.
Well,
or
that's option B.
Or Singapore. Or
outside the U.S., yeah, not to U.S. investors. And there's ways, but there are ways to do it. And so it's really important to do it right, Adam, because, I mean, I think you're right that, you know, something's coming.
I mean, the like blockchain capital just raised $10 million on a token sale, finished yesterday.
To accredited investors only.
To accredited investors, still, like we're moving in democratizing the system. Also, the reason that they're doing it in Singapore or Switzerland is because governments are going to start competing for our business. And I think that's really, really exciting. So,
no,
good times.
I think it's interesting days, but if anybody, I just want to make sure everybody understands that the first wave is done, right? Now we're into compliant token sales.
So it's like, okay if you did it illegally before now.
It's going
like,
to no
like
more.
It's fine because no one got caught. Now you'll get caught.
No, the other thing is, I think, you know, I would say 2 years ago, if you talk to a traditional, you know, sort of Sand Hill Road VC, they would have said you are unfundable as a venture-backed company if you do an ICO. That's starting to change. I'm starting to hear more mainstream VCs say, okay, well, let's talk about what that ICO looked like, and was it a security? Was it, you know, did you comply?
Yeah, like we're having conversations to participate
right.
in the ICOs, like that internally.
Or has it been 4 years since you did your offering and the statute's run now, right?
But I don't think everything needs to be regulated. And this is where I think, so we invest all over the world in many different countries, as does Boost. And I think one of the exciting things about Bitcoin and blockchain and open source is that you don't need permission. It's called permissionless for a reason. And it's great that we're sitting in a room and we're talking about all of the ways that enterprises and governments and institutions will use this technology. But the fundamental idea that got me excited about Bitcoin and blockchain was the idea that you don't need permission. Mm-hmm. You can have truly borderless, frictionless money where you don't need permission. And you can look at another person. Adam and I could sit here and engage in a transaction without approval from a bank or anyone else. No one needs to know why we're engaged in a transaction. That idea of financial privacy and democratizing the way that the financial system works is very exciting. Will it happen in the US? No, never, right? But there are countries like India, like the Philippines, like Argentina, like Chile, like Venezuela, sub-Saharan Africa, countries there, where people are using Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies on a daily basis because it enables them to do things they've never been able to mm-hmm. do before. And it avoids financial censorship and government censorship. And I think these are really important themes that, as a Bitcoin and blockchain person, I just want to make sure we all stay sort of true to those values. While it's amazing that this technology can create value for enterprises, I think we should also look at it through the lens of how does this expand and extend individual liberties around the world for everyone, not just the people who are privileged enough to sit in this room and have this knowledge.
Yeah, I don't want to be too down on token sales either. I mean, because honestly, now we're starting to see sort of almost the opposite thing starting to happen, where we're seeing venture funds forming literally to go and invest in token sales or go and invest in the equity of companies that do token sales, because these token sales are non-dilutive financing. It's actually kind of a really amazing phenomenon. It's even better than government grant, I mean, because you don't have the government to deal with. So, I mean, it really juices kind of the returns that an equity investor could get in a company that is able to raise this kind of non-dilutive financing.
I'll buy some Lowell coin.
Exactly.
top three trends in financing for early stage blockchain companies.
I mean, I honestly think there's one, and it's ICO is like the core trend that I'm seeing in sort of the blockchain financing space,
right.
That everyone's trying to wrap their head around, including us. Like we're still trying to figure out like how it works. Also, as a venture fund, like are we allowed to hold coins? Like I don't know. Like is there regulation around that? Actually, that's a good question. I should ask you that. but. the other trends are just like is this model of doing proof of concepts for enterprises working? Like that's the other piece. Are these POCs getting to market? Are these POCs getting there? And those are sort of the really, and I think a few are, and I'm seeing a lot of exciting things emerge on both fronts. But we're, I think it's great that we have this room full of people who are interested in Bitcoin and the blockchain. It's still early. Like, we're still, all these startups, all of us are just still trying to figure it out. We just know there's something there that we're just going to keep pecking at until we figure out what the true value is. And so that's how I feel about it.
So we're a little bit different. So Digital Currency Group, we're not a fund. We're not a VC fund. We're a company. So we have built and we operate three subsidiaries. One is CoinDesk, which I hope you all read. It's sort of the largest, I think, most recognized media and events platform in this industry.
I had a good article I wrote that was distributed
a great article.
CoinDesk.
Yeah, you should all read it.
You should all read it.
And then we also have an asset management business with $250 million in assets under management that's created a Bitcoin investment vehicles, so you can buy Bitcoin and get exposure to it in your 401k, in your IRA account, without having to custody the underlying. So if you're like, hey, I don't know how to set up a wallet or do all this stuff, I don't want to go buy Bitcoin, I want to go to Schwab and just select a vehicle that will give me exposure to the upside, great. It's like if you could have invested in an internet fund in 1994. That's sort of the idea. Can we create families of investment products that open this market up to retail investors? And then we have a broker-dealer that focuses on the institutional markets regulated by FINRA and the SEC, the only broker-dealer of its kind. And then a lot of what I do is we've invested in these companies all over the world, and the opportunity to us isn't just about being a venture firm and investing. It's about creating an ecosystem to accelerate the development of this technology. So all day I work with corporations, institutions, governments, our portfolio companies, which include SKUchain and ShowCard and Filament, in really thinking about what does the future of this ecosystem look like? How do we help our companies work together? Great example is exchanges. Why do they each have their own integration API? Why don't we all create one standardized API? So if you're building a payments company, you have one integration to build. And so a lot of it's around how do we build an ecosystem and a network to accelerate the development of this technology, but also to help with the education process, to help communicate to regulators, to create self-regulating organizations in cases where there may not be laws yet. This is what one of our companies is doing in India, is they're preemptively creating their own regulatory regime in order to set a positive precedent so that when law enforcement wakes up and says, hey, we should regulate this, they can say, hey, we took best practices from all over the world, and here's what we've been voluntarily complying with for the last 3 years. So I think the real opportunities here are around that ecosystem and really bringing the right stakeholders into dialogues, which is why we love working with WorldLink, because our companies aren't going to be integrating their solutions in 100 different places. They're building the technologies. How do we bring in the right partners, the right law firms, the right systems integrators, the right enterprise technology companies to help them figure out how to do that the right way?
So we're all here as both acolytes as well as apostles. And I really appreciate everybody here coming here today. Now go forth and spread the message that blockchain is where we all need to be. Thanks for coming, folks.